Welcome back, everyone, to the lecture about applied bioimage analysis, this time about the image analysis software ICI. I got slides from Marion Leroux from the Institut Pasteur in Paris. So this will be PowerPoint karaoke part three for today. So ICI is a bioimage analysis software, obviously, and allows quite analyzing images in various ways. Is actually quite sophisticated regarding plugins. So there are many fully functional plugins for doing complicated things. Let's say it like that. So obviously, many developers spend a lot of time in making really user-friendly and user-ready tools which are available inside ICI. So this is how the software roughly looks like. And what is actually quite important to mention, especially at the very beginning, is from the main window in the top left corner, there's the search bar. Similar to what you have seen in Fiji earlier, but I think the search bar in ICI is something like 5 years older. So the developers had this idea earlier, and it's also a bit more sophisticated because you can actually, you search for something and you either find installed plugins, which you can just run, or you find an online plugin, which you can just download and apply to your data. So this is very convenient if you search for things you haven't installed yet inside your ICI. So ICI also has a publication. Please, if you use it, please cite it. Was originally developed by these people. Recently, Marion was joining the team, and I think from the original team, not everyone is still in the group. Stefan is still there and helped me recently a lot with the software. Thank you, Stefan, if you see this. And the aim of the software was like bringing people together, people from different fields, from image analysis, software developers, biologists, to make something which allows the field to advance. And that's actually quite a cool aim if you think about this software. So this is the main interface. You see here again the search bar I just mentioned. You have these main menu, and you have here ribbons where you can click on, and you get then different submenus. So depending on what you want to do, you find different options here. I will show you later in more detail. I have different, let's say, inspectors inside the main window. So this bar on the right is actually quite important. You see the histogram of your image all the time. That's quite practical. You don't have to open an additional window for that. And this checkbox here on top, the auto bounce, is kind of important when you want to automatically adjust brightness and contrast if you want to see the image properly. Yeah. Furthermore, you get more information like what's the pixel size, how many channels are there. So that's all in one view, let's say, easily accessible. Furthermore, the developers also spent quite some time of making this the view of the data appropriate according to what it is. So many microscopy data these days is no longer 2D. We are not talking about two-dimensional image anymore. Many of the processing has to be done 3D for image stacks. And here in the top corner of a typical image viewing window, you can switch different views from a two-dimensional view to an orthogonal plane. So you see the sample from different directions and get also some kind of 3D rendering if you just turned it on. And furthermore, and this is actually quite similar to what you have seen in ImageJ earlier or in Nine, you have the original window, the original image window, where you can see, for example, ROIs on top of selected cells. And furthermore, you have kind of views of ROIs, and you have views of tables, and where you can then later see segmentation results, for example. And also the ICI developers had the idea, which make a lot of sense, to connect their software to other softwares. The interoperability is kind of key. So for example, ImageJ is kind of embedded. You can call MATLAB plugins, and you can actually run microscopes with ICI via MicroManager. So interoperability is obviously a thing in order to make a software survive longer. Again, ICI has many plugins for segmentation using active contours. I haven't shown you how active contours work yet. Let's see if we find time for that. But it's more sophisticated than just thresholding. So you start from a certain initial area, from a certain point, and you extend the contour until you hit some boundary. For example, in this particular data set, the membrane around the cells, and then the segmentation stops. There are some tools for tracking cells over time. You see here, for example, in color expressed where the cell is moving over time. You can do flow analysis. So you see here color coded where intensities are moving fast and slow. So we may also do something like that later on. There is, as I said, many sophisticated plugins which allow you to do complicated stuff in an easy, accessible manner. And there are protocols, so you can build workflows similar like in Lime. But instead of looking at this video in very detail, I will just show you how this works. So this is ICY, as I've showed you earlier. So you see here the ribbons on top, and you can go through different tasks you want to do. Maybe as a very first thing, I will just open an image. And here you see in kind of colors selected the things you can do with your image, you can access other things you cannot do with your image. So for example, I have here a two-dimensional image, that's why I cannot convert it to a stack. That kind of makes sense. Furthermore, if you want to process it, like you know from ImageJ, you can just apply filters to it. For example, we can do a median filter, and this is like one of the typical ICY dialogues. So you can apply a median filter where you enter also here the sigma or the radius, and you can just execute this one and you get a new image out. So that's actually quite practical. Of course, you can apply several radii in a more convenient, easier way because this dialog stays open. But it also means that there are more and more videos popping up. So there are advantages and disadvantages depending on what strategy you use. So this is basically how it looks like when you want to process images by hand. If you want to explore different operations you would like to apply. But what is kind of practical when it comes to automating workflows like we did earlier with ImageJ, Cell Profiler, and Nime, you can program so-called protocols. So I will show you now how to program a protocol. A protocol is similar to a workflow in Nime, a concatenation of different operations. So again, we have our input image. And we want to apply a median filter, we want to apply a threshold to it, we want to do connected components analysis, and we want to analyze the resulting objects. So the first thing we do is we search for the median filter. And depending on which plugins you have installed, this list may be longer or not as long, and you find here the usual median filter. And you select here in the input, you select, for example, you can specify one particular image which should be processed, or you can just say the active sequence. So this workflow can be later executed on other images if you say active sequence. And also here you enter the size. Then the next thing we want to do thresholding. And thresholding in ICY works a little bit differently compared to ImageJ, but compared to other tools, it is actually quite similar. So when you think about how to apply a threshold to an image, it's actually two steps. Because first of all, you have to determine a threshold, the best threshold, which allows you processing your image. And then you have to apply the threshold to get a binary image out. So this is, in ICY, it's two steps. And this is how it works. And this is how all the blocks in ICY can be combined. You start from the median filter you applied earlier, and you take the output, and you pull it over by drag and drop to the input of the other node. So similar to in Nime, but you have all the parameters. You have actually all parameters specified here, which can be applied. So you could theoretically, if another window tells, finds out a good algorithm, you could actually pull the algorithm over here and let this pull down be automatically selected by another node. So I will now manually select Otsu here, and the Otsu algorithm will result in a threshold. So this is a number which comes out here, and I will put in this number into the thresholder window. So we have now from a median filter to a threshold to determining a threshold pulled over the number which allows us to threshold the image. What we haven't done yet, we also have to pull over the image which should be thresholded. Yeah. So I will just move it a bit like that around so you can see that the thresholder takes two inputs, namely the image which should be thresholded and the number allowing to threshold it. In order to check if the result is correct, in order to see if the thresholding worked, we need a display. So you see here, I already entered it in a magic moment. And I can just take the binary image and display it here. And what sometimes happens is that the display doesn't work immediately, so we have to double click here to open a window, and you see in this open window that obviously the binary result looks okay-ish. Yeah. So you can just remove the display again. And the next step would be something with connected components analysis. So we just enter connected components and you find there are several connected components and we are just looking for the simple one. And I, you see, I move around these blocks all the time because my screen is limited. But this is how it goes. And we want to apply connected components to the binary image. So we take that as input. And so connected components is the step in order to get objects out. And afterwards, we would like to do measurements, statistics. And that's why we can enter just statistics here. And you get ROI statistics as one node. And you can just pull over here the list of ROIs as an input regions of interest. And furthermore, you can pull the original image. Obviously, we want to measure intensities in the original image. But here we can also select features, and you see there is a lot of stuff. Everything is pre-selected per default, like in CyProfiler. Let's just measure everything. I will also keep it like that for now. And then afterwards, the result of an ROI statistics is a workbook. And if we want to save a workbook to the disk, I would enter here something like workbook and see what we can do with workbooks. And we can, as an operation, workbook to file. That sounds like something I would like to do. And I just pull over the output workbook to the input here. File format spreadsheet, and I have to select an output file. So I again go to my desktop. And I say, I see result. Yeah, and also here I can select if the file should be overwritten. It's per default on, not too bad in this particular case. Now I will execute this whole workflow. You can also see the workbook file now here. It should contain a column for area. Oh, it should contain a column for area. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, so you see, this is obviously the table. We can also have a look at the resulting file. And here it's basically also in. The question is now how to make this workflow run on a folder of images. And therefore, the IC developers had a very nice trick. So we have now a workflow which can be processed to one particular image. And in ImageJ, we would now program a for loop around. In NIME, we would now, or in CyProfiler as well, we would now select here, likely in this pull-down, not one file, but many files. In IC, it works a little bit differently. We embed our workflow in another workflow. So and in this particular case, you see here, there are actually different ways of doing that. And we have a sequence file batch. So sequences, they are so-called image sequences. In IC, basically every image stack, three-dimensional image, multi-channel image, is a sequence of two-dimensional images. And we have a batch of sequence files, and that's why we use this one. And you see now how our original workflow is embedded as a node in another workflow. You see here, I can move this one around and our original workflow is in here. And the idea of how to do this is now, instead of selecting one particular file here, which is processed, instead we choose a folder in the outer workflow. And that's my test folder where I have several, so I have three images in this folder. And we just pull the input over here. Another thing which is important in order to process several images is in the output of the Excel table, we do not want to overwrite the table. So with every image, we would kind of execute this node and we don't want to execute it several times, overwriting the result from before. We want to merge the sheets and exclude the first line. Yeah, so this we want to append new entries to the other file. And then we can also execute this workflow. It is for IC, unfortunately, kind of necessary that you have a big screen. Yeah, you see it was kind of executing that three times. You also can read here that there were three files in this folder. Then we can have a look in the output. And you will see that there are a lot more lines now down here. So this is how you can analyze many objects in many files. So also ICE has a website. If you're wondering of where I have my knowledge about ICE from, so which is the right way for analyzing labels, for getting all ICE statistics out of your data, I have it from the website. They have a section with training material. So if you want to dig deeper into ICE, I would recommend going there. So with that, we come to the exercise for today. So I showed you three softwares, and I will not ask you to try out all three because you could spend several days on exploring how Cell Profiler, NIME, and ICE work. So in the folder where the slides are, there's also a folder with example images. Example images acquired under two different conditions. And you will see that there, in these images, there are blobs of different size. Try to find a workflow, one workflow, which is capable of processing images acquired under both conditions. So maybe start with the images which have a lower signal-to-noise ratio, yeah, where the intensity is lower compared to potentially higher noise. Try to measure the area of all these blobs and tell me the ratio between the radius between these two conditions. So the blobs in the one image folder are larger than the other, and I would like to know the ratio of the radius between these two conditions. You can do that with ICE, NIME, or Cell Profiler, but you can, if you still want to practice that, you can also do it in Fitchy with ImageJ Macro again. So you're welcome to do that. Pick one of these four tools. And furthermore, there is one fifth way of doing it. It's actually the fastest way of doing it. But have a look a bit at the materials I gave you in the folder where also the slides are. And good luck with that. Next week, we will do a little excursion to the new Bias Academy. We will do a session about GPU Raxer and image processing, which is actually my research topic. And I hope you enjoy this one as well. So see you next week.